Say cheese. Awesome. What a wonderful day. Let's get on with this. First of all, we need to say thank you to the Cogworks. And to make sure that Adam doesn't get too pleased, I've made sure that the logo is low res. But organizing an event like this is an insane amount of work. So please make all the noise you can for Adam and his fantastic crew. This venue is almost as awesome as it's expensive. You should all ask Adam. His children won't be able to go to college, but who cares? I'm here to talk a little bit about the state of Umbrago, where we're going, all that jazz. But first, we need another round of applause for all the issues that was smashed yesterday at the hackathon. So if you participated, get up. And if you didn't participate, then clap a lot. It also smelled like 35 bucks were smashed. It's pretty insane, and I had a blast going here, reading through all the pull requests. It's all that polish that makes Umbrago feel really, really solid, and it's sometimes that tiny details that we don't see, because we don't encounter, and then it's wonderful to just see people fix it. And it's one of the strengths of a project like this, where you don't have to submit a ticket, get an automated reply back saying, thank you very much for your interest in improving the quality of the product, and then radio silence, but that you can actually do something about it. How are you doing? I hope you're doing very well. One of the reasons that we can all be here is I think it's kind of been a theme in some of the talks today, that Umbrago sort of matured, all that things. And in fact, there's Umbrago projects made for more than 150 million euros a month. And I know in Brexit terms, it's actually really difficult to say how many pounds it is, because it's just going like, so I had prepared this, and then I had to update the slides, and I don't know, I just gave up and just did it in euros. I hope that's okay. Also a theme that's been mentioned a couple of times, Umbrago is the world's biggest .NET CMS. This tiny GIF, yep. Notice how I avoided the plague of a discussion on how that's pronounced. Because we all know that I pronounce words 100% correctly in English. This is 24 hours of installs of Umbrago. It's pretty insane. There's now more than 385,000 live installations of Umbrago, so that's installation that pings back to our update checker the last year. There's more than 205,000 developers active on our, so that's people who've had more than 25 sessions on the our side, according to Google Analytics. If we take everybody, it's 1.1 million. It's pretty crazy. And every single day, we see more than 1,000 installs of Umbrago. So that's, it's nuts. And it's kind of a challenge, because how do you scale something that's the biggest thing in the world? As I said many times, this was never supposed to happen. And I'm sorry. But it did, and neither me nor Pierre knows actually how to even run a small business. What we did was we looked around a couple of years ago to see if we could find someone who actually had this experience, who tried some of this before. Because one thing is that we kind of love to have a lot of fun. We might be ironic, etc. But we sort of realized that I think Pete Duncanson said, Umbrago does pay for a lot of mortgages out there, and either we had to sell Umbrago, which we definitely didn't want to, or else we just have to accept the faith and try to professionalize the company a little bit. So we searched and we found a guy who actually can smile. I haven't found a photo of him smiling. But he's a guy called Tom Frigo. He used to be the CEO of one of the biggest software as a service ERPs in Europe. And he happened to live in the city where I lived. So I searched for people, and all these business people are really dull and boring and all about growth for the sake of growing. And then I found this guy, and he was like, well, he did have a growth adventure, but at the same time, he talked a lot about having fun along the way, not forgetting the values. Then I did something, and don't tell anyone, I went on LinkedIn. yeah, it still haunts me. And I did something even worse. I clicked the connect button. And then I wrote, if you're ever in this town, why don't we drink a cup of coffee? And he said, I live in the same town as you. Let's have a cup of coffee. And then we had a couple of sessions. And then he was like, yep, I definitely want to help you guys out. It's a really interesting adventure you got going here. So he became our chairman, or as he preferred to call himself, the cupbearer. Of the company. He sort of guided me and Pierre the last couple of years on how to scale this thing so we can keep growing, but we actually also know how to pay the bills and we don't get caught by surprise. Then after a while, it became clear that this cloud thing is actually what we believe can fund the project. It's a huge challenge to fund an open source project. Many people believe we show these huge numbers and people are like, hey, you must be filthy rich. And we're not, because a lot of people call and send emails, less people buy stuff. But then he said, oh, you call it Umbrago as a service, but where's your service team? And we're like, what? Yeah, who picks up the phone? What? We have outsourced it. And he was like, what? And then he said, you need someone to help you guys. And then he actually brought in his the former VP of service and support. And following the theme of the evil suits in Umbrago, I found another picture of a guy who couldn't smile. But he's actually surprisingly fun. And he joined the company earlier this year to help build up this entire what we call Triple S that Chris talked about, which is a very big part of the company now that we do service, sales, and support. The reason I mention this is you're gonna see these names, and then you might wonder, who are these suits? But we actually, that's the friendliest alarm ever. Oh. While this happened, I will demo Umbrago 2. No. It's still too unfriendly. Do you remember like fire drills in school? It was so scary. This is kind of like you would be drinking beer. You'll be like, this that's not a fire. Anyway, you will see these people at events, and you will of course appreciate that I, even though we hire clever business people, we don't forget spelling mistakes. So everything is as it's always been. And one of the things we always also done as we grew is creating these things that big companies need to: mission, vision, values. I said never, and then they said it's a good idea. I said, yeah, you sure? And we create a mission. Chris went through that, but we also have a vision that's nuts, that we are going to have about 1 million Umbrago sites at 2021, and 10% of them is going to run on Umbrago Cloud. So that's also very important. Sometimes when we talk about cloud or talk about that you have to go to training and all these things, people say, it feels like it's getting more commercial. Dude, that's how we fund the shit. That's why Umbrago exists. But despite that that we're talking a lot about cloud, it's still just 10% that's going to run the cloud, and Umbraco will always stay open source. That's a no-brainer. It's our very DNA. We also have values, and Chris sort of mentioned those, but we actually did a lot of work to find values where there was no difference between what we did in the company and how we and how the project was run. And it's all about trust, that we believe in best intent. We respect everyone. We are open in everything we do, and it's like a cliche value, but we have actually always done it, being 100% transparent. Then that we are hungry, not in the Wolf of Wall Street kind of thing, but we don't want to be satisfied with where we are right now. We want, as Chris said, we want to make Umbraco simpler every single day. There's so much that we can still do in both the product and the community. But most importantly, we are the friendly CMS. And believe it or not, everybody talks about these suits, but for the last, 6 years, we've been trying to find like a catchphrase. We used to be the friendly CMS. It was actually a guy from the UK that coined that one, said, hey, you're the friendly CMS. We had that for years. Then we thought, oh, it's not corporate enough. We need to find something that we had like different taglines. And then Kim and Tom came and they were like, what happened to this friendly CMS? That's what you are. Get that back. So they are not, once again, they are good people. Else we wouldn't work with them. Come on. The most important thing is that it's fun to go to work on Mondays. We've been searching for a CFO. Do you know how hard it is to find a CFO where you were like, I really want to meet this guy Monday morning? It's very difficult. Anyway, let's talk some other things. It's like, what's Umbraco's role in the market? We are often asked, in also throughout the session, what about WordPress? What about Voldemort? What about AP Server? Voldemort, it's the Danish CMS we don't mention. What is actually making Umbraco unique in this market? Why are we here? And the only way I can explain that is to find a very cliche stock photo, which I will find in a minute, because the whole point is that people at top levels in organizations, they are constantly told now that they have to succeed online. It's like, it's the number one thing, right? But first of all, many of these people, they never had digital ambitions at all. They just wanted to create like a furniture company or run an NGO or something. They never really cared about digital. So a lot of them are looking for that one magic tool that can solve everything and just say, hey, to succeed online, look at this suite of awesomeness. And then we stuff you down in the suite and everything will be fine. But the truth is that rarely succeed, and very few people are actually friends with their digital platform. It's kind of a shame, but it's usually because people look at the wrong place. And this is where I really hope that Doc someday will take a photo that I can place on this slide rather than this incredibly cliche photo. The point nonetheless is that the solution isn't about technology, it's about people. And we've been talking about this for many years, but we just have to keep emphasizing it all the time, because this tweet is old. It's actually from 2011 at a CMS conference, but I think it's one of the best way to coin how a digital project becomes a success. It's a little bit about the system, more about the chemistry, and then a lot about competences or talent. Umbraco just need to succeed at those 20%, the rest will sort of be fine. But the thing is, in these systems, everybody isn't looking for those 80%. They're like hoping that it's all about the system is all about 100%. And the only thing I can think of that makes people think this is because, again, they have no domain knowledge about what we're actually doing, how complex it is, what we're doing. And I got reminded about this a couple of years back when I promised my wife that I wouldn't work for a couple of weeks during the summer. I knew then I had to find another project. So I said, I will build a night tower for my kids. It wasn't enough with a playhouse, because a playhouse isn't that tall, so when you fall from the roof, you don't really hurt yourself. It should be very high. So I decided to build that. I went to a hardware store, and I remember the door sliding open, and there it was, like covered in light, this amazing Enterprise saw that cost a fortune, and I thought, this will build the night tower for me. I've never ever built anything in my life. Umbrago is named Umbrago after the Umbreco key you used to make IKEA furniture, because that's the only thing I've ever succeeded constructing. So it was clear if I was supposed to make this night tower, I had to find this magic tool. So I spent a lot of money on this magic tool. I came home, my wife wasn't impressed. Then I unboxed it and got it together, and it turned to be 5 times the size of the box, and she was not impressed at all. But I start cutting down this wood, and then I got to the the poles, and they were too big for the saw. So I had to go back to the store. This, by the way, this one, it had a laser sight. You know, like a built-in laser sight. Not like a creepy add-on, but built-in. Yet it was 2 millimeters off. So even Enterprise stuff have bugs, right? And then I went to the store, and the guy said, you need this. It cost like 1/30th of actually more than the Enterprise saw. I've used this for other projects. I've never used that saw again. It's actually outside collecting rust and spider webs. But the point is, and I could also the 40 cuts of wood I had to make, I could also have used that one. But I didn't know better, and that's the whole point. That's why people are looking for miracle tools, because you don't know. And you have no chance of knowing how to succeed. And that's our job, to make sure that that people realize that. And of course, while the reason why we are so fucking awesome is because we're not just a bunch of dickheads in suits. We're an amazing community. I promise to do 3 swear words during this talk. So when I suddenly do say something like, we're a fantastic community of numbnuts, it's a challenge. But what's amazing about Umbrago is what we've experienced today is that it's sort of this chicken and egg, right? Umbrago might start as a software project. Before the software project, there wasn't a community, but it's really the community that made the software project amazing. Because it is a little bit about technology, but a lot about people. That said, though, when we say that magic comes from the humans, it also puts a lot of demands on us as developers. And one thing we see is, and Per also tried to address this earlier today, is that sometimes things are made too complicated, at least complicated without a reason. And that's why we keep promoting that you have to go to training. Some people are like, I've been doing Umbrago for 6 years and I don't need no goddamn training. and trust me, we see stuff done by people who've done 6 years of Umbrago, and they definitely ought to go to training. So it's really not a waste of time. It's very, very important. Maybe not go to training, but just if for nothing else, keep up to date. The thing about bad implementations is that it hurts everyone. So it hurts the editor who thinks Umbrago sucks. And trust me, we've seen sites with hundreds of nodes all as root nodes, and then in the top root node, you have a content picker and you can select subnodes. Why? There's no wonder that some people out there think that Umbrago is an awful system, because some implementations are really awful and much more complex than they should be. Then some other people inherit these projects, might have heard about, oh, Umbrago is cool, and I think there's a really nice community in London, and hey, I got this chance to work on an Umbrago project, and then they go to this Umbrago project, and it's horribly made, and they think, my God, Drupal is awesome. And if that's the case, imagine how bad the implementation, no, sorry. This is not recorded, right? Anyway, point being, just make sure that you keep your skills up to date. Umbraco changes at a rapid pace. Make sure that you use the best of the features, and make sure that you spend your time on stuff that makes a difference for the editors, not stuff that makes you feel cool. Do it on a side project. Get a fucking hobby. And make some cool stuff there, and make sure that the implementations are well done. That was nice. Now I can breathe again. Anyway, and one of the benefits of going to training is, of course, that you become a partner. And one of the things that Chris also mentioned is that we are increasingly trying to get in touch with partners to hear about real-world cases, the stuff that we actually need to focus on. And of course, we would love to talk to everyone, but we just have to limit who we can talk to. And then we've chosen that it's the partners that we talk to on a regular basis, both one-to-one, but we also have these partner seminars. We also started a project manager training course, which will launch next year, where the idea is that project managers and non-developers can actually learn the benefits of Umbraco and how to sort of sell Umbraco and the strengths of Umbraco in a non-technical way. Even though we have hundreds of certified people, we launched this registered partner program earlier this year, and the purpose is we have, again, hundreds of thousands of people an hour, but we don't know what they're doing. We have no way to have a dialogue with them. We don't know where they work. So we really want to launch this registered partner program where we say you don't have to be certified, but we would love a way that we can communicate with you. And you can either have a path to get certified, or at least we can have a knowledge of how many agencies are actually out there doing working professionally with Umbraco. So that was a little bit of the business side. Let's dive into to the tool Umbraco. And it's, of course, again, some of it is community, some of it is cloud, some of it is core or CMS. And let's start with Umbraco Cloud. The artist formerly known as Umbraco as a Service. The idea of the cloud was that we believe that people working with Umbraco as developers, they should be really good at tailoring and managing Umbraco. They shouldn't have to work on continuous integration, hosting, deployments, all these things. And then a couple of years ago, we started to ask partners, how much time do you actually spend on stuff like this in projects? And when we asked developers, they would say maximum 1 hour. If we asked project managers, they would say a lot. And if we asked top level, they would say, I have no idea. We just have an incredible amount of unbiddable hours in our organization. Then we did a little bit more research. And there's like 8 to 12% of time that's not directly related to coding or to some coding related way to create value in the project. And we thought, hey, if we could just get that down by 1 or 2%, that would be really interesting. Because when we say that it's people who makes projects awesome and not features, well, then the more time people have in Umbraco projects to do real work, the better the projects will be. And we believe that it's a virtuous circle. So if people actually realize, hey, when you do Umbraco, you're actually doing purely the fun side of stuff, maybe we could attract even more talented people to the Umbraco community. So that was the idea. It consists of a lot of things, and I've been mentioning this a couple of times before. But the point is, it's sort of four things. It's great what you could call environment management. So you have the best Azure infrastructure you can get. You can start new projects with a single click. Umbraco upgrades automatically, and people panic, say, no, please don't upgrade Umbraco automatically. It's just patch releases. Relax. When there's a minor upgrade, you get, like on your phone, you get, hey, there's a new version of Umbrago out. It has all these cool features. Do you want to upgrade? And you click a button and it upgrades to your dev environment, and you can test your things, and then you can click another button, and then that upgrade goes live, and you think that's too good to be true, and I say it's getting even better. I've upgraded an Umbrago site on board Turkish Airlines, being insanely drunk in free red wine, and it just worked. Imagine a world where upgrades is like that. That's worth the cost alone. It's also team management. We see more and more projects where you hire in dedicated experts in certain tech areas on projects. It should be just really easy to assign either internal colleagues or external partners to projects without thinking a lot about it. Remove them again. And there's a very flexible security model in Umbrago Cloud now. Great support. That was the thing that we had to learn. A lot, but now we have a dedicated support team. There's a chat inside of Umbrago Cloud, and we respond within 30 minutes, even on quite complex cases. Now, there's also documentation, video tutorials, all that jazz. And then, of course, the very special thing in Umbrago Cloud, what we coin as content flow. The idea is that if something could know everything that's going on, whether that's content in Umbrago or code, C# code, or it's design files in Razor, JavaScript, CSS, whatever, then it would actually be quite easy to know what's going on. And if it's versioned across environments, then it's also very easy to move things back and forth. And the benefit of that is that then you can have this wonderful flow where you don't have stuff like content freeze. Raise of hands, how many heard of content freeze? Yeah, 2016. And you're still like, hey, we're doing a deployment Friday because my boss believe in me working weekends. You can't update your site between 9 o'clock and 1 o'clock. How crazy is that? The idea is that because everything is in version control, you have separate environments, then editors can create content. Developers can then always get the latest content with a single click. That's the other thing. You see that sometimes a client says after a site launch, hey, there's a bug. The developer fixed the bugs. It works on their machine. They deploy the bug fix and it crashes because, hey, the content is different out there. That's the point of a CMS. You tested it with old content. It should always be possible to just grab the latest content without any effort. Then you can test with the latest content. Then you can press a button and you deploy the new features to a test environment. That stuff gets tested and then it goes live again with a single click, and then you can start all over again. And when this works, it means that you can have much shorter development phases in your projects. So you actually deploy something, you learn from it. Does it work? Doesn't it work? And then you improve, and then you rinse, repeat. That's how you do product development today. Yet, a lot of website projects are still way too long release cycles because this is too difficult. So let's just demo some of it. Some of you, how many seen demos of Umbrago Cloud? No, you haven't, because we just changed the name. I'll go through the basic demos quite fast. So let's just get going with this. So this is how it looks. It's you have the overview of projects. If you want to create a new project, Per also demoed this. You just click a button. You can choose different plans. We also have customized plans now, dedicated resources if you need have special requirements. You click a button and you go, this is cool, give it a color. You click a button and then your project is set up. And that's not just an installation of Umbrago. It's a working, hosted installation of Umbrago with source control, Git running underneath, permissions associated, and you have one single login, whether that's for your Git repo, for the back office, or for managing the portal. You can also say, oh, wait a second, we always do the same kind of sites, or sites with a little bit of variance, or 80% of what we do across clients is almost the same, then you can have baseline. So you can say, hey, this new project, it should be based on a project I did before. And then Umbraco will actually not take a copy, but it will clone the project. So later on, when you have 10 sites based on the same baseline and you realize, shit, there's a, I've been a numbnut. Look how elegant that was. I've been a numbnut, even a dickhead, an American. And there's a cross-scripting issue, then you can fix it in the best baseline and you can push that fix out, because underneath we use Git to manage the different versions and we can actually do mergers that way. So that's kind of cool. Anyway, we'll just start this, click a button and everything is set up. It takes like 30 seconds and then you're ready to go. Then if you have an existing site here, I have this very beautiful site here. And you want to work locally because you're like, hey, I don't want to work directly on a service. I want to work on my local machine. Well, then there's many options to do that. You can just clone it down with Git and open it with Visual Code if you want that. And we have a Visual Studio setup tool that you can use. So you go to your local machine. You run a command line tool called UAS, because we're really good at consistent naming. And then you just paste in your Git clone and your login and password, and then it generates a Visual Studio project for you, separated by both a web project and your custom code. Also, if you're a front-ender, you're working on a Mac, and you're like, I hate having virtual machines, then you can install a CLI, where you can just type this command, again, consistent naming, called UAS watch. Then what it does, it asks you to connect with your username and password, and then it actually opens a direct pipe between your local Mac installation and the service, and then it will monitor changes you do on your file system, and it will stream those changes and stream the server-side result back to your Mac. So you can sit on your Mac, not install Umbraco, use your favorite tool, and content and changes are streamed back and forward. In fact, if I change content on the live side that's running on the service, it will be automatically streamed and instantly updated on your Mac, and you never have to install anything. So also your colleagues that are front-enders, and they're like, oh no, not yet another Umbraco project. Until we have Umbraco running natively on a Mac using .NET Core in 2032, this is another option, and this is only possible because we're running on the service. Then one of the cool things, other cool things, is that I have, for instance, this site here, I have another navigation that I don't have locally here. So let's look at the site on my machine here. You can see, I'll just refresh. This is an old version before the site went live. And there's no Anthony Dang's hangover cure. Here's the content tree. You can see it's not here. But I can say, hey, now I'm now I need to work on a bug fix. So I say, hey, give me the latest content from either the development environment or the live environment. I click a button, and then from anything from a couple of seconds to a couple of minutes, then it actually fetches all the latest content to your local machine, and you can actually start working on your bug fixes with real content. And it's local. It's not like it's a shared database somewhere. This is a local machine, local database instance on your machine. And that's one of the principles of the service, that you can actually collaborate without interfering each other. So if we just refresh this, we should see Anthony Dang's hangover tips. And of course, the number one tip I talk to him is always bring out the photo of Adam, because then you feel much better. So that's a couple of cool things on the service, on the cloud. I encourage you to, if you haven't tried it before, go check it out again, give it another try. If you already tried a trial and it's blocking, just get in touch and you can try again. We also lowered the pricing earlier this year, so it now starts at 25 euros a month. That's including everything. It's a fixed price. And we also made a cloud referral program, so you as an agency can get between 10 and 20% referral fee every month, recurring, based on how many sites you're doing and whether you're certified or not. So that's kind of cool. And there's more, because we're working on other things. So actually on Tuesday, because Tuesday is our rollout day, how corporate is that? We're actually rolling out some new features, and one of them is what we call pending changes. So one of the ideas with the service is that you should really have an overview of what's going on your site. And the idea is that when you go to your project, whether you're a project manager or a developer, you can actually see, so what's been happening on my site since we last did a deploy. And now you get an easy overview. You can see like avatars of colleagues who've actually worked on stuff lately. So if it's only a picture of you, you know, okay, whatever, I'll just do the deploy. And you can actually go into details and see what changes has been made across different categories, from changes in code, design, upgrades, schema changes, and the magical other category. And again, you can even dive further and see exactly has stuff been added, modified, who did it, what happened. It's getting rolled out on Tuesday, and this should hopefully make it even easier and more comfortable to do these regular deploys. What we're also rolling out on Tuesday is Courier 3. We've been working about that for a long time. It's the Shannon-fied version of Courier that's been in test the last 2 months. It's more than 30 times faster than Courier 2. And of course has a lot of bug fixes. We're also working on something we call Umbraco ID, which means that you have one login across anything in Umbraco. And then this thing, which is our code name is Das Button, but it's actually a migration tool that you can get, put on your non-cloud website. Then you type the alias of your cloud project and your credentials, and then it will work for a little bit. And then it will actually, first of all, upgrade your local instance to the latest version of Umbraco, and then it will transfer everything to Umbraco Cloud. So it actually takes, I think this is a, this took like 7 minutes, but me and Pierre also mumbled a lot along the way. This is the short version. This is director's cut. And contrary to normal director's cut, it's from 7 minutes to less than 1 minute. But it means that you can also evaluate cloud in a much easier way. It will loop from now on. But it means that it's easier to evaluate cloud, or even if you want to get rid of your old dusty VM that you're always panicking about when you go on holiday, then it's easier than ever to move to Umbraco Cloud. It's coming eventually. We are testing this a lot. It won't, you know, it's not magical. It's not like it can move any type of complex site. But this was a relatively complex site with a lot of nodes using ArcType, and it just worked, trademark. But we'll have more testing, then we will have it out as an experimental feature, and then you can play with it. So again, go to umbraco.com/cloud, give it a try, wait until Tuesday, because then pending changes is there and Courier 3 is there, and it's a completely new experience of the Umbraco Cloud. We're quite proud of it. And really excited to hear what you think about it. One last added benefit of running this cloud thing is that your reality actually becomes ours. So sometimes when you do products, you sort of test with the same thing. You have a mindset, this is how Umbraco is supposed to work. We never thought that someone would make an Umbraco site with 1.2 million nodes. We never thought that people would think Umbraco is only for root nodes. Hierarchy is overrated and really difficult to pronounce. all these weird scenarios that people encounter, and we see that on the cloud. So we learn much more about how Umbraco is in real life. It affects how we do the core. It affects how we performance optimize things. So everybody benefits from this. And we get a much better understanding of what Umbrago actually should be. Which then leads me to the best thing about a big open source project. Actually, it doesn't have to be open source. It just has to be a trustful project, one where we say, okay, me and Per and I might be product owners, but we're not the cleverest one in here. And everybody heard about wisdom of the crowds or collective intelligence, but this project is actually that in practice. And I have a couple of examples of this. One is that we talk about building simpler sites, and it's easy for us to say because we just do starter kits. We don't do real projects. Some people don't know this, but in the HQ, we don't do implementation work at all. We're not an agency. We're solely a software company. So apart from when our moms or dads need a website, we don't really build websites anymore. But then there's cases like what you do where you have quite complex sites and you have front-end people working on it, you have C# developers working on it, and they sort of need a common vocabulary. And we used to have XSLT, which was great because it was consistent. Everybody hated it. It was not like, you know, when front-enders complain about it being complex, C# developers could be like, yes, it totally sucks. And everybody was happy. Then we introduced Razor, and developers loved it. But for designers or front-enders, it was quite complex. And it didn't help that there's actually three ways of doing Razor queries on it. So one of the ideas, one of the things we worked on is this thing called Models Builder. And it's actually insanely complex technology that uses Roslyn compilers in the background to generate C# classes that C# developers love based on how your document types are. But the benefit of this is that it gives front-end developers a really nice, simple vocabulary and way to create templates, which means that they don't have to worry about complex C# queries or how advanced property editors stores content. And just to give you an example of this, I have this page called Products, and I have this wonderful list of products. It is a real product, so if you've never ever been to Code Garden, this should persuade you that it's totally worth going. You will have a 1 in 500 chance of actually winning something like this. And we do have a bouncing castle that wasn't picked up by the French guy in a two-bedroom apartment who won it, despite that it was only 125 square meters big. It was black. Imagine the French sun warming it up. It could do wonders to your skin. Anyway, but as we do more Code Gardens, we'll have more products, and the list becomes totally impossible to manage or to overview for visitors. So of course, we ought to make a custom property editor here that made it nice to sort of pick featured products. We didn't. We were lazy. So we just pick something built in, and then an editor can sort of say, oh, these are the five things that are important. The problem is, in the old days of Razor, you had to know lambdas and crazy C# syntax to use or to query the multi-node tree picker. With the Models Builder, you actually have much simpler syntax, because for each document type you make, there's C# classes generated. And you're very clever, even when you have composition of document types, you also have sort of compositions on your classes. So let's, if we look at the source code here, then we can see we just query the children. This property is called featured products. If we look at the document type, if we look at the document type, we can see the alias for this is featured products. So thanks to Models Builder, all I need to do is say featured products. I save this and I can just refresh my, let's see if we still have my local site running here. And then it actually does all the magic. So it knows anything about the complexity underneath thanks to something called property value converters. Which means that, again, no matter whether you're a C-sharp developer or a front-ender, you can actually start coding in the same way. The syntax is easy to understand, and it's very consistent. Oh, and by the way, I did this on my Mac. Did you see that? Yeah. So that's one example of how we can use collective intelligence, all this knowledge in the community about how should great query be, to actually come up with a solution that satisfies everyone. Another one is experience as packages. I think that might be the best example. So there might be hundreds of pull requests for the core, but there's actually more than 1,000 Umbrago packages out there. We had the package repository or the Umbrago App Store a year before Apple introduced their App Store. Unfortunately, we were developers, so we called it package repository because it sounds complex and unsexy and like something you wouldn't want to use. And we also made sure that even if you wanted to use it, the UI was horrible. And if you tried to search for a package, it wouldn't show up. So that definitely needed a lot of love. And in 7.5, it did get a lot of love. So let's try to take a look at the new package section. So it's been completely redesigned. The first thing you see is that you can actually search for packages. I want to install this personalization group. You get all the data from our in a really nice way, nice overview. You have the compatibility checks, and actually with new packages, we can test whether they are compatible with your Umbrago installation, and then you won't be able to install them if it's not compatible with your version of Umbrago. You click one button, notice that it no longer says, "Are you insane? Don't do that." And you don't even have to read what it says because it's so ugly that you would think that something is wrong. Actually, Microsoft approached us saying, could we have that UI for our new yellow screen of death? It was almost that awful. No, now you actually search directly, you click one button, and the install process starts, and it's very wonderful. The same if you try to install a new package, it's also very nice. You can just drag it in, and it will start installing the package. So very nice as well. And then another area is this thing about that we can't just be web developers. We have to be security experts as well. I mean, at the DK Festival, we had a security guy from Deloitte. That sounds boring, right? He did the ending keynote. Imagine what Pierre and I thought when we read that. We're like, what the is... do you want a numbnut at the very end of a festival? It turned out he wasn't a dickhead. He was actually amazing. And he talked about all these challenges that we as web developers have to face and how nobody cares about security. It's like it's nobody's responsibility. And he said the first thing you should do when you make a new project, you should just ask who's responsible for security in this project. Is it me as a web developer? Because then I would need time. If it's me as a web developer, I would also need a lot of knowledge. But one of the things that's very great about being in a community like this is that there are some wonderful people out there that actually think security is interesting. And these people, they actually gather info and best practices on keeping your Umbrago site secure. And then based on early work from Matt Brailsford, we made something called the health checker, which is here, that can actually check a lot of things on your Umbrago site, but including some other things. It's my certificate that's wrong right now. But including other things, it can check integrity. It can check whether your different security settings is up to date or not. It will think a little bit, but let's go to something else. It will check your indexes, all these kind of things, and you can write your own tests to that. So as security holes, for instance, in your implementation, like preventing clickjacking, etc., that you wouldn't know how to deal with, the community can actually share checks with this, and then before you go live, you can click a button and you can actually check whether your site is secure or not. So it's kind of cool. Another thing is, as I mentioned, you can contribute to these things. So let's say you have this really, it's not like it's something that would happen in real life, but just imagine that you have this very important conference, you go live, and then like a couple of days before you think, robots shouldn't really be able to index this site. That's a stupid idea. It's very overrated. So when you Google let's just imagine you would Google for Umbraco UK Festival because you thought, hey, maybe it would be nice to see the program. The site doesn't exist. And that's of course because it's sold out and Adam was tired of people stalking him, wanted to get tickets. But anyway, it's not really best practice. Sebastian, just this day, he actually made a check for that. A very simple check, so it will actually check whether you had this disallow everything, and there's even a button that you can click, and then it will fix that issue for you. The same with various security things, such as different types of headers that either should or should not be on your site, that you can fix that with a single click. So that's a very great example of collective intelligence in practice as well. So you could sort of say that Umbraco might be a piece of software, but it's also this combination of the software that improves and helps you become better, but it's also this community where you become better in real life, both at conferences like this, but also stuff like the fantastic initiative called UMBX, which is this series of workshops on, for instance, load balancing, Marcello, much more that you can volunteer people organize, and for a ridiculously low fee, you can actually attend these workshops and learn a lot. And I think it's one of the things that make this project very unique. Then the last thing on my mind is this, you could call it development versus implementations, and it's kind of like when can you say that you implement a piece of software, and when are you actually starting developing? And the reason I ask this is because, again, when Umbraco is compared to other types of systems, it's fair enough that they offer all these features. But what makes me wonder is, if they do have all these features, why do you have to spend so many hours implement these features? Maybe you're actually not implementing. Maybe you're actually developing something from scratch, which doesn't have to be a problem because sometimes you have to tailor-made stuff for your customers. But then why are you paying twice for it? And it's one of the things I love with Umbraco, that we're not a suite. We love to make a CMS, and that's the thing we do. We don't know anything about commerce. We don't know anything about marketing automation, that kind of stuff. But there's so many people that do. For instance, with Umbraco, you have multiple completely integrated e-commerce options, depending on your budget or how your client works. It's not like you have Umbraco Commerce and you have to, you know, just deal with that. And then when you get outside of native Umbraco things, you have so many SaaS-based marketing automation tools, from email campaign to relevance engines, personalization engines, etc. And because everything is online anyway, it's really relatively easy to integrate these things. And then you can select best of breed rather than a single suite of components that apparently doesn't really work anyway. And I think that's a really wonderful thing with Umbraco. And I sort of brought a small example of this. It's a Danish, so omni-channel or cross-channel is all the rage. And you would say, I need these big enterprise systems to be able to do that. But one of the biggest electronic chains in Scandinavia called Power, they actually base their entire business on Umbraco. And it's the craziest omni-channel you'll ever see. So this is actually editing SAP data live from inside of Umbraco. They have price robots that monitors competitors, and editors can say, how much do we want to lose on products before we take them offline? And whenever competitors change prices, their Umbraco installation will ping their SAP, change the price, and they have e-ink price tags in stores, and the prices changes. In fact, the agency behind it have a demo where they update the price in Umbraco in the store, and within 5 minutes, the price tag changes. And the point here is that you don't have to, aim low with Umbraco. It can do so many fantastic things, and it's so easy to tailor Umbraco to your client's needs rather than trying to bend some sort of stock feature from another system. And this is a cool example as well. This is custom grid editors, where the editors can search, again, their SAP system directly, pick the one they want, and then it sort of generates a featured item based on live SAP data on the website. For the editor, they don't have to know. They just have to search for the product or know the code, and then they can work with SAP data just like it was Umbraco content on their site. The best thing about all of this, though, is that as these insane projects, like these role model projects, create some of this, then because we have this ethos of sharing in the Umbraco community, all of this benefits us all. So sometimes I hear Umbraco doesn't do personalization, but is that really true? Because it's relatively easy to integrate stuff like Raptor or Rich Relevance that are dedicated companies doing nothing but personalization because they love it as much as we love CMS. They have great APIs. And it's Power uses Rich Relevance, for instance, to do suggestions based on behavior. But not all of us need those crazy things. But then we have the best community. And for instance, Andy Butlin, who made this personalization groups that I just installed before, I've added it to this project. And having Anthony's hangover tips on a Friday makes us look very unserious. So it makes no sense that we show that in our navigation. But thanks to Andy Butlin's personalization group package, we can just say, hey, okay, then we only show it in the weekends. So we look great and serious today, and then tomorrow, when we feel sorry for ourselves, we actually get help. And it's really easy to use. So you just create different groups here. I created weekends, but you have so many options like based on geolocation, how many times you visited the site, time of day, various cookies, and you can personalize per request, per session, or a persistent cookie. But I made this weekend thing, and then I can just go to this. Really, you can't. Let's just have 5 seconds where we look at this picture. Then you pick, for instance, the weekend group, and you publish this, and then the navigation is, of course, updated. And now you don't see Anthony's hangover tips until tomorrow. And this is free. This is awesome stuff. There was something that Zone needed in one of their projects, and yet they chose to release that for the community so we can all benefit from it. And all of a sudden, the idea of advanced personalization in projects goes from something that needs a huge, a sweet product into something that's actually free and can be implemented in hours, in fact, less than hours. It's so cool. Here at the end, I just want to say we've never been stronger. This crowd speaks for itself. It's the same pattern we see all over, that the project grows and grows and grows. But yes, we do crazy stuff. Like we're the first true mover within the cloud space, within .NET CMSs. All the others are just hosted CMSs. We actually try to use the cloud for something else. But yet, we've never ever forgotten who we are. We never forget what our culture is, which is being open source. And no matter how much we speak about the cloud, there would be no cloud without the open source CMS. And again, one in 10 projects in 5 years would be on the cloud, and the others would be on a native open source version of Umbraco. And every time we learn something on the cloud, we improve the core all the time. So, and I think you've seen some stuff today, but there's so much in store next year. We'll see version 8, which we've been working on for a long time, with new cache. which is a much more flexible caching engine in Umbraco that can also handle much more data. We'll see native multilingual support, variants, segments, and a lot of other stuff in 2017. So with the danger of sounding like a cliche that repeats itself, it's never ever been a better time to be involved in Umbraco. And I think this day and you being here and the way that you've been smiling, the glimpse in your eyes that I've seen throughout the days, sort of just approve this. Big high five, you rock, and thank you very much to everyone for believing in this crazy, crazy project that was never meant to happen. Thank you very much.